when we recognize the victory that we already have, when we walk in the victory that we already have. And it doesn't matter if you haven't been, this year you get to. This year you can. This year can be the change. You get to be the love of Christ wherever you are, in whatever influence you have. 3,000 were added. It's going to happen. It has to happen. No, this year I declare that our Red Frogs ministry in EH is going to explode, that we're going to see salvation after salvation after salvation flowing in. We're going to see the fruit and the goodness of God. This year we are going to see the miraculous signs of God. You are going to partake in the miraculous signs of God. You are going to minister the miraculous signs of God. Mark 16:16 says this, that these signs will follow all those who believe. They will cast out demons in my name. They will heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead. They will speak in new tongues. It's us. It's our time. It is this generation. Jesus is in us. We have everything that we could ever need, and it's time to put the foot down. This is the year. This is the year. This is the moment. This is the time. Our friends need us. Our family need us. We have got to declare freedom from fear. We have got to declare freedom from that issue that stops us from witnessing, that stops us from giving them the very thing that they are searching and desperately at. And it is Jesus. That deep desire that they go clubbing for, that deep desire that they give themselves away for, it is Jesus. He fills it and we have it. And we get to give Him out. We get to pour Him out. We have got to break that fear. And tonight, when we go home, tonight, tomorrow, when we go to church, we have to be a people, when our feet hit the ground, the devil gets scared. He's like, they are awake. This generation is awake. Come on, we got to wake up. We have got to wake up. Lord, we commit this year to You. Lord, we declare freedom and breakthrough will flow. Lord, we declare that we will submit to You. Lord, that we will resist the devil. And Lord, we will see the generation around us one. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. And tonight is going to be a great night. We are going to be blessed by Pastor Joel. We're going to have a ministry time a little bit later. It's going to be a fantastic finish to our Accelerate retreat. So I invite you to go and grab your seats. Bump into someone gently on the way there and give them a smile. Awesome. I encourage you, grab your Bibles, grab your notepads or your pens or your phones and get ready to jot down some nuggets of gold, because we are going to be blessed by this ministry. Pastor Joel is a Brisbane boy. He might not sound like it, but he is. And God has called him to this city for a season, I believe, before he's asked to go somewhere else. I firmly believe that for you, Pastor Joel, that this is a season in your life and you're going to see incredible things happen in Brisbane. So I want you to put your hands together and welcome him up as he comes to preach to us and minister tonight.
Amen. It is so good to be with you guys. Have you had a good time so far? Wow. Well, I just told Pastor Joe just before, I almost didn't make it. So I just I flew down from Melbourne, and I was just looking at my flight itinerary, and I thought I had everything sorted. So I went to the whatever D48 on the whatever wing it was, and so I'm like, sweet, I got enough time. I returned the hire car. I got there. I'm like, I've got at least 15 minutes to go. So I ordered myself a salsas and just got myself together. And then when I went down to the gate, and I realized this is the Jetstar end. And none of the Jetstar people would tell me anything about Virgin. As soon as I mentioned the word Virgin, they didn't want to know me. They're just like, yeah, you're going to have to figure out it for yourself. And I couldn't find any information whatsoever. So my flight is like boarding, as starting to finish boarding. And I'm running through the airport like a madman. Do you ever get to that point where, you know, you don't want to make a scene, You know, like you might be in the airport and you kind of want to get to your destination, but you don't want to be that person that's kind of running through the airport like a madman. Until you get to that place of total urgency, when you realize that you're going to miss your flight and you have no idea what's going to happen next, it doesn't really matter what people think. So I'm running through the airport. I already went through the bomb test. I tell you what, they pick me out for the bomb test every single time. So I already did the bomb test. I already took my laptop and everything out of my pockets, and I had to go through that again, and I get hit up with the bomb test for the second time around. And I'm on my phone to my wife. I'm like, can you please call Verge and find out where my gate is? I felt like it was Jack Bauer and Chloe. Chloe was kind of, I don't know if you've watched 24. It might be too old for you guys. But anyway, I made it. So I made it at the gate just with a couple minutes to spare. So it's so good to be here with you guys. And can we just honor your Pastor Joe? I tell you what, this is an incredible man of God. I walked in this place, and I sensed the Spirit of God doing something incredibly powerful in your midst. There is a strong anointing, and I really felt that there's just hearing you share, man, I can feel it's echoing the heart of the Father to see souls for this nation for 2018. I was just over in Melbourne, and I was spending time with a guy named, has anybody heard of a guy named Ben Fitzgerald? Not a one of you. Well, you know, that's what's pretty awesome is that he's just a guy from Melbourne, and he had a big vision. He went over to Bethel for a few years, and he's like, I believe that we can see Europe saved. Now, Europe, the continent of Europe is probably one of the most closed places in the world. In fact, Reinhard Bonnke, they said in about 2008, 2010, Reinhard Bonnke, who pulls big crowds, could only get stadiums full of about 4,000 people. Not a whole lot. But he says, I believe that we can start to see stadiums filled with Jesus lovers in Europe and all throughout the region. And I tell you what, one Melbourne boy, he's 35 years old. Come on, I just stayed in his house in Melbourne. He's a good friend of mine. I knew him before he was famous. He was just sharing into like a group of about 20 people, just sharing about prophecy. That was the first time that I met him. And now they are ministering to tens of thousands of people in Europe every single year. Come on, they said it couldn't be done in Europe, but they are seeing a move of God's Spirit, and tens of thousands of people are now being activated, and they're sending out to the streets, and signs and wonders and miracles are breaking out. And so now we're going to be doing something called Awakening Australia. They've already booked out the Etihad Stadium down in Melbourne, and where they're expecting tens of thousands of people in Australia. Come on, how many believe that we're living in exciting times? You know, it was prophesied by Smith Wigglesworth that the last greatest move of God would happen in this nation. Come on, how many believe that that's pretty exciting? The last greatest move of God would happen in the nation of Australia. In fact, there's one of the most significant prophets of his time. He died about three years ago. His name's Bob Jones, and he had a word where he actually died, and he went to heaven, and he stood before Jesus, and Jesus told him that there was going to be a billion soul harvest. And an Australian guy named Chris Harvey went over to the United States. He's never met Bob Jones. He's never spoken to him, but he really felt on his heart to go and track him down. So he went to his house, and he knocked on the door. Now, Bob Jones is from the deep south, and he answers the door. He goes, I've been waiting for you. And so he opens the door, and then he begins to prophesy over the nation of Australia. He said that same visitation that he had with Jesus in the 70s were the beginning of the billion soul harvest that would begin to usher in the last coming of Christ. He said that it would happen in southeast Queensland, and that it would begin to spread like a figure nine throughout all of, it would go down to Victoria, it would all go over to Perth, and then it would begin to eject many missionaries to all the nations of the world. Come on. I believe that we are living in a Kairos moment. I am sure that a whole bunch of you are trying to figure out where I'm from, so I'll just answer that question. How many of you are wondering that? How many of you think that I am under 25? Thanks, man. How many think I'm under 30? Okay, cool. 32, 34. So I just turned 36. So I'm actually surprised that there's normally more people that think that it's about 10 years. It's a stubble, yeah, isn't it? So what's the age demographic for young adults here? 70 to 35. So I just missed out. I appreciate it. That's why I have to stand here on the stage. I can't actually be seated with you guys down there. I just wanted to show you a video of a couple of things that have been happening in Australia. I am the campus pastor of Glory City West. Have any of you been to the Tivoli Drive-In Cinema before? You know, there's Yatla Drive-In Cinema. So we actually own that drive-in cinema. It's pretty incredible. So we got about 75,000 people come in every year to the drive-in cinema. And we put on, how many have ever watched the Normal Christian Life videos? Any of those? Give me a big wave. I would encourage you, just put that in your phone, The Normal Christian Life. You'd look it up on YouTube, Facebook, or thenormalchristianlife.com.au. And myself and Nathaniel, it's mainly Nathaniel, but I do help him out. He's got a series of videos on there. And one of his latest videos has actually got more than 11 million views and more than 400,000 shares amongst a few different Facebook pages, and it's gone mega viral. And his daughter actually died for 4 minutes, and they prayed for her, and she came back to life. The doctor said that she would never recover again. She's not showing any signs of brain activity or anything like that. God completely and totally healed her. It's an incredibly touching video. But we've been releasing this media, and it's been touching people all over the world. And we're even seeing Muslims watching the video saying, you know what, I prayed along with the prayer, now I got healed, and now that I believe that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Come on! That's coming from our nation. But I wanted to show you a couple of videos of what's been happening recently. I showed this at youth, but I love to show this video because it raises an expectation of faith for miracles. And I find every time that I play this video that the percentage of people that get healed in the meetings actually begins to go through the roof. So can you play that one, The Blind Eye, or Brawny? It's called something along those lines. You got that? Just give me a thumbs up if you can find that there, and I'll just share one other thing. So it should be called, you good to go? Yep.
Hey, this is John.
This is a different one, but that's all right. I'll play this one. This is a guy that I met out in our local neighborhood, and we've been trained in with an evangelism tool called Three Circles. So I just met him on the bench, just had a chat to him, shared the three circles. It indicates, you know, are you in God's perfect design or are you in brokenness? And he said, I'm in brokenness. Where would you like to be? And he says, I want to be in God's perfect design. And I start to share about what it means to really make Jesus his Lord and Savior, and that includes baptism. And he says, I'm all in. I want to give my heart to Jesus. I said, man, when do you want to get baptized? You want to get baptized on Sunday? He goes, no, I want to get baptized right now. So my friend Nathaniel was actually taking my daughter home, and so we flagged him down. We jumped in the car, and 20 minutes later, I baptized him in my bathtub. So you can go ahead and play that. He's a big guy.
I baptized John in the bathtub. Well, right now, John, in the name of the Father and of the Son, can you come help me just pour this over his knee? And the Holy Spirit, we just baptize you right now.
We do believe in full immersion, so this is why it was particularly challenging.
Get your face under.
Amen.
There we go.
Jesus. Amen. Amen. Lord, we just thank you, Father, for John. Amen. I declare that this man shall see many, many people come into the kingdom
Amen.
Of heaven. In Jesus' name.
Yeah. You can end that one there if you like. So. Have you got that one, the blind eye one, Brawny? Is that one ready to go? You know, yeah. Nope. That's an Iranian guy. I can talk to you about that one in a second. I also run a thing called the Glorious School of Supernatural Transformation. And in one of our very first sessions, a guy named James Marquette, he was in one of our sessions, and the Holy Spirit was moving so powerfully that he was so impacted and so overcome with the presence of God that he went up to the Ashgrove Day and Night Pharmacy or something like that. He walked in, and there's a guy that went into cardiac arrest and actually died on the floor of the pharmacy. And he's still so filled with the power of the Holy Spirit that he calls out and he says, it's okay, I'm a Christian. He runs up and he takes a hold of this guy's foot, and you know, they're trying to resuscitate him and everything like that. And he said he felt power go from his shoulder out through his hand, and immediately this guy came back. In fact, the guy that was trying to resuscitate him, he said, this was crazy. There was panic in the place, but then as soon as this guy said, "It's all right, I'm a Christian," there was peace that entered into that place. So come on, how many believe that God is the same today, yesterday, today, and forever? I was just down in, as I said before, I was just down in Melbourne. I wanted to give you a couple sort of up-to-date testimonies as well. And I was with Ben Fitzgerald. He's bold as a lion. We're going through the car park there, and we're on an elevated car park, and there's like a grate, and over down the bottom there's like five or six guys with beers. I think they're like bikies, and he calls out to me. He goes, "Hey guys, I just want you to know that Jesus loves you, man." And then these guys start calling back, and it goes back and forth. And one of the guys starts to get really heated. He goes, "Man, I'm going to beepity beepity. I'm going to bust your head open, mate. You come down here and all da 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 da." Like, he was so cranky, man. So Ben and I, we ended up going down there. We had two pizzas with us, and we offered these guys pizzas. So this guy was a little bit drunk, and as soon as we walked down there, everything changed. These guys really opened up to us, and one of the guys said, "You know what? I never believe in God. I've never seen anything. I've never seen any miracles happen. Don't believe it. You know what? I'd have to actually see something in front of my face in order to really believe in God." So we asked him, "Is there anybody here that we could pray for?" In fact, I showed him the video of the blind eye that we're trying to get up there. I showed him that video. He goes, "Man, that is crazy." And then after that, we asked if we could pray for one of the guy's backs. He had a really bad back. Prayed for his back. He was completely and totally healed. He was blown away. And the guy's like, "What the heck?" You know, his mate got healed. And then, have you got that one with the guy's leg? There's a guy that's like a full length photo there of a guy. There we go. Yeah. So this guy, have a look at his leg. So on your left hand side, you can kind of see a line there, and his leg's slightly red. Both of his legs were bright red when we prayed for him. The guy goes, "Look, I will believe in God if you can pray for my friend who has got an infection in both of his legs, if the redness will actually disappear." So we prayed for him, and look at his other leg. His other leg was way redder than his left leg. His other leg is now was completely normal within 1 or 2 minutes. And the other one, you can see where the line was, that the redness was all the way up to the knee, and it started to shift as we were praying. These guys all were freaking out. Come on, how many believe? You know that it's actually designed to be a show and tell gospel. Jesus said, "Heal the sick and tell them that the kingdom of God is near you now." That we actually demonstrate and we manifest the kingdom of heaven, and then we preach the word of God. So that was pretty exciting. That was just yesterday. We've also been training some people in evangelism, and there was a couple named Danny and Sarah that had taken those tools, and they'd given to one of their Tongan friends, and they had gone to a wedding, and they led 50 people to the Lord within 2 hours. This is like 4 weeks ago. 4 weeks ago in a wedding, these guys got so on fire, they just led 50 people to the Lord. Come on. Is that exciting or what? Can you turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 11? And I want to talk to you about eternity. How many of you made New Year's resolutions? Not many. How many of you broke your New Year's resolutions already? You know, the New Year is always a great time to begin to think about our lives and what we're here for and goals and things that we want to begin to plan for the future. And Ephesians chapter 3, verse 11, it says, "He has put eternity into a man's heart." I believe that it is so important that we live with an expectation that it's much more than simply what we experience in this life. How many know that when your life ends, it doesn't just end? Come on, how many of you are born again in this place? If you are born again, if you are saved and you're sanctified, it means that you're going to an eternity with Jesus. Eternity is forever. I wonder if I can I just, will that pop if I pull this out? I'm going to grab hold of this this cable here. Now, I don't know if you've seen this. Francis Chan has a fantastic illustration of eternity. I don't know how many of you have seen that before. So if this represents your life, the silver bit here, how many of you are under 30? So you're not even, you know, a third of the way through your life. You still got a reasonable amount. Let's say the little black bit probably represents a lot of you. So you're only, you know, 29% cooked. You still got some time. So you want to begin to plan for the future. How many of you are planning for the future? How many of you are studying for the future? How many of you are thinking about your superannuation? How many are investing? Less and less. Where's my crypto crazies? Any Bitcoin people here? No? Okay. A different kind of crowd. So most people, they spend the majority of their life planning for this little thing at the end, which is called retirement. I believe that it is so important that we plan for our future, that we make sure that we're making good decisions today that affect our future. How many have had mom and dad tell you that? You got to make sure that you plan for your future. You're not going to get a job playing Xbox unless you're one of those few elite people that just test Xbox games. You want to actually get an education. You probably want to get into the real estate market because, you know, if you're renting, it's dead money. There's a lot of expectations, but I want to tell you that those are all good things, but the end of your life doesn't end there. I believe that the majority of the body of Christ are planning for their future for this tiny little end bit here, and they're neglecting all of this. I want you just to picture for a second, if this cable, which came out on the other end, if this cable was attached to all of his pedals there, and it continues to go down through the stage, and then it goes up towards the north side. It goes past your church in Warner. It goes past Gympie. It goes all the way up to Cairns. Then it goes past Indonesia, and then it goes all the way across the globe, and then it goes to the other side, and then it goes past the moon, into outer space, into infinity. Do you know what? If you take any number and divide it. If you take any number divided by infinity, do you know what the answer is? Or you take infinity and divide it by another number. That's right. Thank you. Mathematician there. No? What is the answer? Zero. Zero. How many know that Bitcoin is exploding? They said that if you had $100 in Bitcoin in 2010, you would have $75 million right now. How many wish that you could get in a time machine, go back to 2010, take $100, put it into Bitcoin? If you were able to go back, would you think of probably putting a bit more than $100 in? Really set yourself up for life. Come on, that's only 7 years ago. That means it's $1 million payback every single year for $100. How many are a little bit of stingy if you had $100 on you? Any stingy people? No? You can point to the person that's a stingy person. You know who they are? No, just kidding. If you had $100, just $100, you could have made $75 million by 2017. That is a good investment. That is a good return on your investment. But I want to tell you that in Earth, if you invested in Bitcoin on Earth in 2010, that your investment into eternity pays far greater dividends. It will continue to be repaid year after year after year, 10 years, a decade, 100 years, 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years, 1,000,000,000 years, 1,000,000,000,000 years. Did you know even if you divide eternity by a trillion years, you still get zero because we will be living for eternity. But so many times people are living just for the here and now. And I love what Francis Chan says. He says, you know what? You're making decisions here that could be affecting here. Are you crazy? He says, no, you're crazy. Because if I don't do this here, it affects all of this. You can talk to me. C.S. Lewis says this. If you read history, you will find that the Christians who did most for this present world were precisely those who thought most of the next. It is since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world that they have become so ineffective in this. Let me read that one more time. If you read history, you will find that Christians who did the most for the present world were precisely those who thought most of the next. It is since Christians who have largely ceased to think of the other world that they have become so ineffective in this. How many of you got those car games? I used to play a car game, and you sort of start with a little bomb. And then you race your way through and you get credits, and then you can kind of upgrade your car. And then if you're really, really good, you could get a Ferrari at the end of the day, right? You know, I think that when we stand before God on Judgment Day, you know, I used to dream of getting a Ferrari. How many of you dream about getting, maybe some of you got Ferraris. You can take me for a drive. But some people might spend their entire life with a dream that if I could just have a massive apartment and a Ferrari that everybody would look at me and they'd think that I was so cool, I would be willing to invest my entire life into beginning to pursue that. That would be as crazy when you look at it through the lens of eternity of somebody that's playing a computer game for their whole life and they say, I got it upgraded to a Ferrari. Everybody looks around and like, well, that's awesome. But you can't do anything with it. There's nothing that you can take with you in this life except for what you have done for the kingdom of heaven and with souls that you have won into his kingdom. Come on. You know, I actually started a company called Australian Listings. I started a whole bunch of different companies. I ran a graphic design business. I ran a web design business. You know, it was going to be the next Mark Zuckerberg. And we had this, it's kind of like a twist on Yellow Pages. And I had people working for me in Mexico and India and different places in Europe. And we had this one guy, the first sales rep that we put on was making us, in the first week and every week after that, and it was increasing, it was making us $4,000 a week, and with one sales rep. All we were doing was selling listings. It didn't cost us anything. So we could have put on a team of 20. We could have put on a team of 50. I mean, the sky was the limit. We were starting to make some real potential. But I want to tell you that began to consume me. I was consumed by business. And I never really thought that I had a love for money, but I think it was more of a love for success. And money was the bottom line for success. I'm like, I'm gonna press. I was a worship leader in a church, and then different things happened, and so I really shifted to, I shifted towards the business realm. Now I believe that there are many people that are called to the business mountain to do amazing things, to be very wealthy, to be able to support the kingdom. I believe that with all of my heart. But I want to tell you that for me personally, that my heart was not in the right place, and it was pulling me away from a relationship with God. And I want to tell you that when I was 8 years old, I began to seek the face of God. Sometimes up to 8 hours a day. When I was 14 years old, I got to encounter the presence of God. I grew up in China. My parents are missionaries over there. I encountered the presence of God for the first time. I'm like, I'm giving my life for this. I tasted something that I can never go back. I can never leave it behind. I tasted something that is nothing in comparison to what this world can offer me. And so when I began to pursue this business thing, I remember it was so difficult that when I was praying, I was just totally distracted by all of the business dealings, and I would be on Skype and I'd be talking to my employees and I'd be getting, you know, new ideas and everything like that. And I felt like I missed God. I missed my relationship with God. Now, a lot of people could say, Joel, you know what, if you would have held on to that business, maybe you could have sold it a few years after and made a few million bucks on it. You know, maybe I could have had the Gold Coast apartment. Maybe I could have had that Ferrari. But I want to tell you that it was pulling me away from my relationship with God, and I don't know where I would have ended up if I continued down that path. Material possessions are nothing in comparison to what God has to offer. I let that business go. I didn't even sell it. People say, that's crazy. Well, it's crazy if you're looking at your life from this sense, from just this little thing. It's crazy because if I'm just planning for my nest egg so that I can retire well. But I don't just intend to retire well. I intend to retire well. Come on, man. I want to live for His kingdom. Do you know that there's a big difference between living for ministry and living for the kingdom of heaven? I found that out early, very, very early on, that I was climbing the ladder of success, that I was defining what I did based on whether the platforms that I had or the positions that I held or everything like that. Again, in the same way, in the business realm, I was defining myself by my bottom line. In the ministry realm, I was defining myself based on my position and the number of people that I was ministering to. And I was doing it for me and not for the kingdom. Turn your Bibles to 2 Corinthians 5, 1 to 11. My grandmother just passed away about 3 weeks ago. She gave her life for the missions. She was one of the most amazing, amazing, amazing women that I've ever met. She loved so well. She was so incredibly selfless. Not a lot of people on this earth know her, but I want to tell you that in heaven that she's famous. It says in 2 Corinthians 5, 1 to 11, it says, for we know that if this tent, that is our earthly home, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, from the eternal heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to put on our eternal dwelling, if indeed by putting it on, we may not be found naked. Somebody say, we will not be found naked. That'll wake you up. For while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, that we would not be unclothed, but further clothed, that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we always are of good courage. We know that while we are home in this body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and home with the Lord. So whether we are home or away, we make it our aim to please Him, for we must all appear. Somebody say all. What does all mean in the Greek? All. For we must all appear. This is Christians and non-Christians alike. We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that everyone may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are known is to God, and I hope it is known to your conscience. I want to tell you, the whole concept of fear of death in the body of Christ is a bizarre concept. If you truly believe that you are born again and that you are going into eternity with Jesus, that there should be no death, there should be no fear of death. Here's Paul saying, I long to be further clothed with immortality, that I will be with Him no longer in this earthly tent, this earthly dwelling, but I will be with Christ for eternity. That he is longing for that day that he will be truly united with Christ. You know, there was we had a guy. I think I put his photo up. We've got that Iranian guy. It says Iranian convert. This guy came all the way from Iran. I've kind of covered his eyes because it's I won't say what his name is. But we led him to the Lord. We actually invited him to live in our home. He got radically transformed. In Iran, it is absolutely illegal to convert from Islam into any other religion. In fact, his own cousin was killed by her father because she converted to Christianity. So he came over to, I won't tell you all the full details, but there was, that was part of the reason that he actually came over to Australia as a refugee, and he was full of anger and he was full of hatred. But I want to tell you that he actually sent a DVD and a video to his uncle, and he says, "Uncle, I want you to know that I forgive you and that I love you and that I've met Jesus." This man, we sowed into his life. This man actually is responsible for leading another 60 Muslims to the Lord and personally baptizing them. Come on. And I remember him coming to me one day, and he said to me, I was teaching at our school, and he said to me, he goes, "Joel," my friend Joel, he actually couldn't speak any English. We taught him English when he was living with us in our house. And he said, in my country, there are 7 million people that don't know Jesus. He goes, "What's happened if they don't know Jesus?" And I said, "You know what the Bible says? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through him." He says, "But what about my people in my country? 70 million people in my country. Most don't know Jesus. Who will tell them about this Jesus?" He says, "I see many people in Australia, and maybe they might go to a nice place like Hawaii or America or some place like that to share the gospel. But because my country is a closed country, who will go to my country?" And he says, "I would be willing to go to my country. I know 1,000 people in Iran that knew him when he was a Muslim, and that he would be binge drinking and he would be sleeping around, all kinds of things that are totally against the Muslim faith. But," he says, if I were to go back to Iran, I could convert 1,000 people to Christianity." And we said, "Man, do you understand the implications of that?" He goes, "Yes." He goes, "My Jesus died for me, and I would be willing to die for Jesus." Man, he started getting death threats, and he was living in our house. His uncle is high up in the mosque, and he was threatening to send over some assassins from Iran while he's living in my house. I love what they say in Bethel. They say, "You cannot threaten me with heaven." Come on, man. You can't threaten me with heaven. I know where I'm going. You can take the head off my shoulders, but you can't take away my peace. Because you see that is the reality that Paul was living in, that we're not living by natural sight, by natural senses, about this realm that it's like a vapor. It's going to be in a moment. Your life is going to be here and it's going to be gone. Man, I tell you what, I feel like being 8 years old was just yesterday. And now I'm 36 years old. I'm listening to these old guys where they're like, "Oh, you know, it's time just seems to be accelerating." Time is accelerating. But would you live for eternity? Come on, it is important to be planning for the future in this life. But what is far more important is to be planning what is going to be happening in eternity. We will all stand before the judgment seat of God, and we will receive according to what was done in this life. And he says, "Because we know the fear of the Lord, we plead with others." Continuing on in 2 Corinthians 5, 17 to 21, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation." Somebody say, new creation. "The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to God who through Christ reconciled us and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Who has the ministry of reconciliation? Who has the ministry of reconciliation? Wave at me if you have the ministry of reconciliation. Is it just the evangelists? Come on, man, it's the body of Christ. If you've been made, how many of you have been made a new creation? If you've been born again, you've passed from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. You've passed from the kingdom of death into the kingdom of life. But not only that, now you have been given, he says, tag, you're it. I got the ministry of reconciliation. I was reconciling the world to myself. And now tag, you're it. You have the ministry of reconciliation. That Christ was not reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and trusting us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. Somebody say ambassador. Say, I am an ambassador. Who's an ambassador? What is an ambassador to do? What does an ambassador do? Represents, that's a good definition, come on. Represents the kingdom of another place, which means that you were actually placed on this planet. How many have ever thought that, why didn't you just pray a prayer and go straight to heaven? The reason that we exist is to worship and be in fellowship with God for eternity. But the reason that we're still on this earth is to be salt and light to those that do not know him yet. Come on, this is our identity. This is who we are. We've been made new, but we've also been made ambassadors of the living God. I want to tell you that that is an incredible, amazing privilege that we can bear the very name of the King of Glory. He says, I trust you so much that you're going to be the one that is going to represent me. We implore you on Christ's behalf. Be reconciled to God. I don't buy into a universal reconciliation, because if everybody had already been reconciled, then there would be no reason that we would need to plead with others to be reconciled. Just saying. For his sake, for our sake, he made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. Come on, man. I believe that if we begin to not just be led by sight, the natural senses, this life is deceptive. It's so easy to get sucked up into its desires. You know that there's four kinds of seed that Jesus talks about. The first two seed don't survive. The first one lands on the path and it gets swooped up by the birds. The second one has very shallow ground and it gets scorched by the sun. Both of them are not in the church. But the last two kinds of soil are in the church. There's the ones that have thorns and the ones that are fruitful and produce 30, 60, and 100 fold. The ones before them, they get crushed by the thorns. And Jesus says it is the lure of wealth and the desire for other things, and the worries of life. Those are the three reasons why people are rendered fruitless. I want to encourage you to begin to think about that. That do not allow the lure of wealth, the worries of life, to render you fruitless. If I could exhort you, I don't want this just to be empty words. I could just preach a message and you might be able to pat me on the back and say, oh, that was really well articulated, whatever. I'm not interested in that. What I'm interested is to begin to exhort you. I pray that because of this encounter that I have with you tonight, that if I could stir you up and that you would begin to say, you know what, I'm actually going to begin to make some changes on Monday and in 2018, that I'm choosing to live for the sake of the kingdom of heaven, that I'm not just living for the end of my life, but I'm living for eternity. That I'm not just investing in earthly Bitcoin, but I want to exhort you to invest in heavenly Bitcoin. It's way better. It's way, way better. Come on, man, $75 million in comparison to the rewards that are going to be dealt out in heaven far, far, far exceed that. Is there a video there that you can play with? There's some girls lying on the ground. It's called Myanmar revival new, or Myanmar new revival. Was this? Okay, so sweet. If you could just pause that. That's awesome. Thanks, guys. Can we give these guys a big hand? We so appreciate you. This is crazy. I was just over in Myanmar, and I was spending some time with a guy named Benji Morf, who's planting hundreds of churches throughout Southeast Asia. And he invited me to preach on the Sunday morning. The AOG church was packed. but then on the Saturday, on the Sunday night, there was it was so packed that they started moving to the other churches. So this is a region that 100 years ago, they used to be headhunters. They would kill people, and that most houses would actually have heads or skulls on sticks in front of their houses. And the Spirit of God moved throughout that region, and almost 100% of them are now Christians. And this is the very first Baptist church. In fact, this is being closed off because Myanmar is a Buddhist nation. It's being closed off because it's predominantly Christian from the outside world. And they've just opened it up in the last year. And so me and my friend Nathaniel had a privilege of being able to be the very first white people to preach in the very first church in that region in Myanmar. And so these are really conservative guys. So we were the first white people in the first church, and we gave the first altar call in the Baptist church. So people came up the front the following night. I wasn't expecting to preach. It was a long week, and these guys came and said, "Hey, there's a bunch of guys at the handful of guys that are waiting in the Baptist church for somebody to preach to." And so they're looking around the team, and Benji Morf goes to me, goes, "Oh, Joe, you want to preach?" And I'm like, "Oh, not really. I was ready to go to bed. It was a long week." So anyway, I went down, and I'm like, "I'm just going to preach what I preached in the morning." So I preached it, and they were reasonably responsive. And then we started laying hands on people, and not much was happening. Then something just so supernatural happened. I laid hands on a little 3-year-old, and just went out under the presence of God, like she was just. It looked like, you know, probably to the parents, it looked like she had a seizure. And then bam, 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 all of these kids are just going down in the presence of God, and this started to get out of hand. Instead of get crazy, these ones are starting to scream like it was a Baptist church. And I'm like, Holy Spirit, I don't know what to do now. This is crazy. This is not what I was envisioning in my mind. But the Holy Spirit came over, and he invaded that in that room. And I just wanted to play that clip in a moment. But we went and interviewed these girls, and I want you to hear what one of them said.
I see Jesus, and she said, "My daughter, I will be with you. Go and tell the Lord." And so, and then I replied, "Lord, I will serve you all of my life," she said.
Wow. I wasn't even talking about evangelism that night. I was talking about righteousness. And there were 6 of these girls that we interviewed. I mean, there's probably more, but we only interviewed 6 of them. And all of them had open visions of Jesus, and he commissioned them as missionaries to the nation of Myanmar. Come on. This is real. It's something that is so on the heart of the Father. You know, I want to tell you, you may not think this about me. You're probably thinking, you know, I'm an extrovert because of the way that I share. But I was known by my mother as painfully shy. I was one of those kids that if, you know, you were in a prayer meeting with 3 or 4 people, and I hated popcorn prayer, you know, where it's like, it's going to come to you, and I have to pray, And my heart would be beating out of my chest, like I was just so, and I'd be stumbling over my words, and I mom didn't make it any better. She called me painfully shy. Like now, I already had a complex, and now I'm aware that people, if they were to look at me, I'm so shy it's painful to them. So I might as well just put like a bag over my head or something to save people's pain, you know? Like my brother was the extrovert. It was kind of a Moses and Aaron type deal. Like I wouldn't talk out in public. I would just whisper in his ear, little witty jokes, and then he would just blare them out and they think he was the funniest guy. But, you know, there's been times where I've actually had to push myself. I'm like, Lord, I want to live for eternity. I don't want to just go through life and see people. I want to tell you, there is a heaven and there is a hell. There's no two ways about it. There is a heaven and there is a hell. That is one of the reasons I believe that the fear of the Lord, where it talks about the fear of the Lord, that when we stand before the judgment seat of God, that because of the fear of the Lord, that we persuade others. I believe it's for two reasons. It's because that there's a reward that is associated with us standing before God. I pray that when I get to heaven, that my works will not be burnt up, but I will have gold, silver, gemstones to be able to show things that were done for the sake of the kingdom and not done for my sake. But the other reason as well is because we know that the judgment seat of Christ, because we know that everybody else out there, if they don't know Jesus, that there is a heaven and hell that was created, a hell that was created for the demons. And sin has separated us from God, but Jesus has made a way that he paid the price, that he became sin for us. I want to tell you that we can't keep it to ourselves. I love what William Booth says. He says that he had this vision of people out in the tempest and Jesus was rescuing them into the island. And then they got to the island and the strangest thing began to happen. They forgot about the other people that were in the ocean that were drowning and sinking. And they were more concerned about debates and theological issues. And they forgot that Jesus was actually out in the ocean. And they were crying out for Jesus to meet them. And they said, but Jesus was in the ocean crying out, will you come and help me? I said, Lord, if I truly am living for eternity, I am bound by the fear of man. I am more concerned that I might get into an embarrassing situation or an awkward conversation where I might lose face, but instead somebody might go into hell. If you knew that there was a bomb that was about to be placed in a mall, you could be the shyest person. What would you do? You're the only person that knew that there was a bomb that was about to go off in 5 minutes. What would you do? What are you going to do? Come on, what are you going to do? Talk to me. Tell everyone. You're going to shout. Who's going to shout? Would you care what people thought? Do you think that people would probably think that you're crazy? But it doesn't really matter because you know that this is an urgent situation. I think that one of the reasons that there is an apathy within the body of Christ is because we're not looking towards eternity, that we can hide our head into the sand and say, you know what, we kind of know this theologically, but we're not confronted with the truth of the reality that there is a heaven and a hell, and we are ambassadors of the living God. Come on, man, for so much of my life that I was bound by that fear, and I'm like, I can't do it. I can't approach strangers and everything like that. And I made a commitment with some of the guys. I said, you know what, I'm going to step out every day. And I remember the first time that I went out, I'm like, man, I do not want to do this. I don't feel like I want to do this at all. And I'm like, maybe I could chat to that person. And I walk up to them, and, you know, their wife comes by, there's like two of them, I don't want to kind of interrupt them, and so I go to the next table, and I don't know if you've ever been there, but I was like, I was on this journey, and then I stepped out, and I shared with somebody. I want to tell you that after 5 days, a boldness started coming on me, and I'm like, Lord, I want to really begin to experience your heart for people. And so I went into the Red Bag Mall, which is not far from where I live, and I was walking along the sidewalk with this guy, and I said, hey man, I just noticed you got a bit of a limp there. Do you mind if I, you know, we're seeing all kinds of miracles and things like that. I was wondering if I could pray for you. He goes, oh, you're a beepity Christian. He goes, oh, you know, all priests are pedophiles, and he goes, who created God? And, you know, he's just throwing all this stuff at me. And I'm like, this is quite a long conversation. And he was so bitter towards the church. And I just looked at him, and I'm like, Lord, will you give me your heart for this man? And he said he was 80 years old. Was it maybe 70 or 80, I don't know. Can't remember. I took him by the hand at the end, and I shook his hand, and I looked him straight in the eye, and I said, man, I want to tell you, the thing that would make me the most privileged person on the planet is if because of this conversation, and I believe with all of my heart that there's a heaven and hell. Well, people say, you don't say that, but I want to tell you, when you speak with compassion, this is not a turn or burn gospel, this is the truth of Jesus Christ. It is good news. I said, man, I believe that there is a heaven and hell. And I want to tell you that if I could meet you on that day that I stand before Jesus, that when I come into heaven, that you would be there and you would say, thank you for having this awkward conversation. And now I get to spend eternity with Jesus. And as I'm sharing, my eyes are welling up and tears are starting to stream down my face. And I'm just feeling the love of the Father for this guy. This guy turns, and he's just been spewing out hate the whole entire time, and he looks at me and he goes, you are the first genuine Christian I have ever met. And he could see that the wall that was built up for all those years began to melt. And he goes over to his car and he goes, you know what? I've got a praying wife. I saw his face. I believe that there's probably 80, 90% chance that he's gone and now committed his heart to the Lord. I believe that that moment, that awkward conversation that we initially had, where it even felt a bit like, whoa, this is out of my depth. Because of that conversation, I believe that now he will be spending an eternity in heaven with Jesus. Come on. I'm going to bring this to a close. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10 to 15, it says, according to the grace of God, giving to me like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each take care how he builds upon it. Somebody say, take care. This is your life. Do you remember the old Switchfoot song? This is your life. Are you who you want to be? Come on, we're still young, or you're still young. I've just crossed over the threshold. I was a young adult in September, but now I'm just an adult. So, let each one take care how you build upon it. Man, I tell you what, that this has been my prayer this year, that every time that I come before the Lord, I say, God, I don't want to live for myself anymore. There's been so much of my life that I have spent for me. But I don't want to do that anymore. I want to live for him. Let everyone take care of how he builds upon it, for no one can lay a foundation other than what is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, or precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each one's work will be made manifest, for the day will disclose it. We're talking about the day of judgment. The fire will test what sort of work that each has done, for the work that everyone has built on this foundation suffices, and he will receive reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though himself will be saved as through fire. So who's he talking about? Christians or non-Christians? Christians or non-Christians? I know we read it pretty fast. It says that it is possible that you can get to the day of judgment and have all your works burnt up, but still be saved. We're talking about somebody that is a Christian. Somebody that is a Christian that can stand before God and realize, okay, I'm saved. I'm still I'm entering into an eternity with Jesus. But everything that I've done in this life can be like wood, hay, and straw, that when it goes through the fire, that nothing comes out on the other side. Would you live for eternity? Would you make a decision that in 2018, I believe that I want to live my life by three things. Number one is abide, that we would abide deeply in Christ. The second is that we would listen, that we would hear his voice. You know, I think that many times people give up. They're like, I tried hearing the voice of God, but they haven't really spent time waiting on the Lord. You know, I waited until I was about 34 years old before I actually really started journeying with the Lord, and God began to speak to me in such powerful ways. I would encourage you, young people, would you take time to truly hone the art of listening to the voice of the Lord? Get out books. Do whatever you need to do. Hear the voice of the Lord. Abide, listen, and obey. Abide, listen, and obey. Can you say that with me? Abide, listen, and obey. that I want to abide deeply in his presence. You know what? Some of you might be called to the mission field. Some of you might be called to the business mountain. Sometimes the most spiritual thing that I can be doing, I remember I was seeking the Lord. I said, Lord, I want to listen to what your voice is saying. I will do anything. Send me here. Send me to the nations. Do this. And he goes, I want you to love your wife. Okay. What do you want me to do to love my wife? And he said, clean the room. In that moment, the most effective thing that I could be doing in the scheme of eternity is be cleaning my room. Isn't that crazy? But I'm like, there's nations to be won. Abide, listen, obey. I want you to love your wife, and her, and your wife's love language right now is cleaning the room. So the best thing that I can do right now at this moment is to love my wife. There's been times where I'm pushing my daughter on the swing, and I'm thinking about, you know, the next mission trip, and the Lord says, I want you to stop, and I want you to be present in this moment. The most effective thing in that particular moment is to truly be loving on my daughter. Will you stand with me? Maybe I could get the worship team up. I pray with all of my heart that in some way that I could exhort you, to impact you, to be able to live for the sake of eternity. As C.S. Lewis said, that those that are most effective in this life are the ones that think most of the next. I want to tell you that that is truly, the majority of the time, that is truly how I'm living my life. Just before the worship team plays, have you got that for this cause? Can you just put that up there if you got it? Okay, just pause that for a second. How many have heard of Carrie Jobe's song, For This Cause? I don't know if any of you have seen this clip. I've taken out all of the full-on bits, but this is actually the Egyptian Coptic Christians, and they're being taken to be executed by ISIS because they wouldn't renounce Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And there was one day there that I was like, Lord, I truly want to live for you. And I want you just to watch their faces. I put that before this cause. There's a line right at the end, just gets me every time. And it says, I pray that this would be known of my life, that I would live more to build your name than mine. There's been times in my ministry where I know that I've done things to bring glory to myself and not to him. But I refuse to live in that place any longer. I want to tell you the most honest place that I can be is that when I get up in the morning, I picture myself standing in the throne room of God, and I say, God, here I am, here's my life. And I want to tell you that I've everything that is laid bare, that when you begin to put the throne room of God in front of your eyes, it doesn't matter who is looking. There could be a million people around me, and it doesn't matter what their opinions are. But there's only one opinion that matters in that moment, that when we stand before the judgment seat of God, and that is Jesus Christ and him alone. We are not compared by what each other are doing. Many times, if you watch the normal Christian life videos, it says that average Christians measure themselves by other Christians, but a normal Christian imitates Christ. The only one that is truly worth imitating is Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. You will not be judged by the way that you have acted in your club, even if you're just a little bit better. But you will be measured by the word of God. I want to tell you that I pray that I would live not to build my name, but I would live to build his name. These guys are moments away from spending eternity with Jesus. And if you see on their faces, that many of them are actually singing Amazing Grace. They're not walking by sight because they have nothing to fear. Their earthly tents are just being taken away. And now they get the martyr's crown. I pray that as you watch this, that the Lord would begin to speak to your heart, and you say, Lord, I want to live for eternity in 2018. You can go ahead and play that.
is to be known for loving Christ, to build his church, to love his bride, and make his name known far and wide.
Just as that continues to play,
Jesus,
I want to give you an opportunity,
Jesus,
to say, yes, I want to live for the cause of Christ. I'm going to kneel down here at the front if you want to join me. But in this year, in 2018, these men, my heroes, they were able to meet their Jesus and receive the martyr's crown. Now, this is not a call for martyrdom or anything like that. But what I want you to know, that when you begin to see their faces, this life is so short, it's but a moment, it's but a vapor. But I could exhort you, would you live for the cause of Christ? If that's you, I want you just to come in the front here. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we surrender to you. Let it be known of my life that I lived more to build your name than mine. For those of you that are saying, I want to live for the cause of Christ, will you pray this with me? Father, I surrender to you. This is my reasonable offering, to offer myself as a living sacrifice, that you paid it all for me. So I lay everything down at your feet. I pray that every distraction, every lure of wealth, every worry of anything else in this life would be removed, so that I could live fully for your kingdom. Take this life. Take this heart. I surrender to you, God. Oh, come on, just say that right now. From the depths of your soul, I surrender to you, God. Come on, let this be a moment, a Kairos moment. I pray with all of my heart that this would not just be another altar call, but this would be a moment that things begin to change. God, we say, we surrender all. We lay it all down at your feet. Come on, God is beginning to move upon your heart. Lord, I thank you, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, for this incredible group of young adults. Lord, I thank you, Father, that you do not need golden vessels or silver vessels, but all you need is yielded vessels. It's people that would lay their life down for the sake of the gospel, who would say yes to you unconditionally. Come on, I want you just to begin to say yes to him. We say yes to you, God. We say yes to you, God. I believe that there is an awakening in the nation of Australia, that I look at other nations and I look at those girls that were so gripped with for the sake of the gospel, that they saw an open vision of Jesus, and Jesus commissioned them to go and see those within the Buddhist communities to be saved. But I want to tell you that in the nation of Australia, that one of the biggest demons has been materialism, but I believe that is being broken, that apathy and complacency is being broken over the church, and that there would be a yes that would be heard across this nation of people, of young people, that would say absolutely yes. Lord, we don't care that we live in a first world country, that we don't have to live in a third world country to be your missionaries, but we say absolutely yes, God. We say yes, we say yes, we say yes. We surrender to you, God. We surrender to you. We surrender to you. Oh, let the fragrance of surrender just begin to lift it up. Yes, we surrender to you. All we are, all we have, we surrender to you. We surrender. We surrender. Lord. Wonderful Jesus, wonderful Jesus. God, we choose to invest into heavenly treasure. We choose to invest in heavenly treasure. I want you just to begin to see a picture of yourself standing before the judgment seat of God. Lord, I pray that when we look back at our life, that one day in 2018, that you said, because of that one moment that I absolutely chose to live for the sake of the kingdom, now I have all of this treasure and this gold and silver to be able to present the king, because I lived for the sake of your kingdom, for your cause. I live for your cause. I die. I surrender all for the cause of Christ. We lay it all down at your feet. You deserve nothing less than all, and all to thee, Lord, I surrender. All to thee I freely give. I surrender. I surrender, Lord. Oh. blessed Savior, and I surrender all. Sweet surrender, I surrender all. I surrender all to thee. Unto thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Just stay there, just get comfortable. If you're a little uncomfortable, just get comfortable, just stay where you are. Lord, we give you this moment. Wholeheartedly, Lord, we give you this moment. Lord, speak to our hearts. Lord, reveal the first person right now that we need to share your love with. Jesus, show us their faces and reveal their names. For the first person this year that we need to witness to pray for, to share your love. To know you personally. Lord, that we can be instrumental in seeing them. Lord, that we could cast aside all fear, all inhibitions right now. And Lord, that we could see that person saved. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the things that we cannot see. We might not be able to see that right now they are saved, but we get to hope for it. And it's the faith that we have that will see them. come to know Jesus. Spirit is starting to stir some of you. And I really believe He wants you to speak it out. So I'm going to open up this moment right now to all of you. If you want to declare something, I invite you to speak it out loud, pray it out loud. We're going to agree with you. Maybe it's a prophetic word for us. Maybe it's something from God to encourage us for this year. If you want to pray it, if you want to share it, I encourage you. Be bold in this moment. Thank you, Jesus.
I was just thinking of when the world was created, obviously God spoke it into existence. For God, it would only take one word. He would know the intricacies, the depths, everything He needed to create what He wanted. That same intricacy, that same depth would have been thought about when He was creating us. I just feel like there's a depth, there's an intricacy, there's a power in the word that God has for us that we're not unlocking, that we're not using, because we'll go, well, I don't know what that word is. We don't have to know. God said it. We don't know how the world works. We don't know why the earth is in that tiny gap that we can exist in. But it happened. And if we just believe the word that God has for us, believe the word that God created us with, we'll just go.
Amen.
I just saw over this place, there's such a fragrance in surrender that you guys carry. And I saw over what you've been pressing into. And it was like there was this this dam wall. It was there was a crack in it, D-A-M. There was a crack in it. It was beginning to spill out a little bit. And I really believe that in 2018 that there's something that the Lord is actually doing on prayer as well. I feel like that you guys have been pressing in. You've been pressing in. And I believe that you guys are going to begin to see just, I see that dam wall just coming open and there's like a gusher. And I so honor you, Joe, man. I honestly, the passion that you have for souls, I feel like it's like you've, you know, it talks about the persistent widow that's just been has just been before the King, before the King, before the King. I feel that you are a man like that, that you've been before the courts of heaven, and you're making those demands. Lord, we have to see more people coming into the kingdom of heaven. And I believe, and I saw it's like the Spartans' army. I see that there's giants around you. There's warriors around you that are going to begin to lock shields. And I really believe that there's so many of you in this young adults ministry that are saying, you know what, we're going to stand. We're going to stand shoulder to shoulder, that we are not accepting anything less than a full-blown move of God on our college campuses, in our workplaces, in our neighborhoods. How many feel that that's on your heart? That there's no plan B?